Good afternoon, viewers. The Counseling Cell of Gyan Prasarak Mandals College and Research Center, in collaboration with Sangat, warmly welcomes our principal, Professor Dr. D.B. Arolkar, our resource person, staff and students of the college, and all our participants to this webinar on grief management. I'm Melanie Braganza, student counselor of the college. The duration of the session is of approximately 40 minutes, to be followed by an interactive question and answer session. Kindly type in your questions or concerns in your inbox. They will be addressed at the conclusion of the session. I request all participants to please turn off your mics and videos. Thank you. I now wish to call upon our principal, Professor Dr. D.B. Arolkar, to welcome our resource person, Mrs. Miriam Sequeira, and the participants of this webinar.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to this webinar on grief management organized by the counseling cell of our college in collaboration with Sangat. In a special way, I would like to welcome amongst us Ms. Miriam Sequeira, who has agreed very kindly to conduct this very, very important webinar in the current time of pandemic. I'm sure all of you have seen, felt, and you know, experienced the impact and the bad, you know, what you say, the effects of this pandemic. And Goa is no exception to it. In fact, at one time, our positivity rate and the death rate was the highest among the country. In fact, there were times when we lost our loved ones, our neighbors, our friends, and so many people known to us all of a sudden, and we find it in such a short time. And it was really difficult for many people to come to terms with this loss. And with this background, one day one of our teacher, Ms. Prashanti, came to me and said, "Sir, why can't we organize such a session?" And of course, then she spoke to Ms. Melanie, Anupa, the vice principal, and others. And we said that this is the right time wherein, you know, at least let us provide some guidance to everyone, to the students, the teachers, and the people around us, how to cope up with this loss. And that's why we are here today for this webinar. I'm very glad that Miriam and Sangat, you know, they agreed to conduct this session, which is going to be very, very beneficial to all those who have logged in to attend this session. Once again, I welcome all of you, all the participants, as well as our resource persons for this wonderful webinar on grief management. Over to you, Ms. Melanie.
Thank you, sir, for highlighting the importance of having this grief management session. All of us experience grief at some point in our lives. We often associate grief with the death of a loved one, and this can be the cause of intense grief. We are seeing it today in a big way in the form of the pandemic, which has left a trail of unprecedented loss of life, leading to a surge in cases of anxiety, depression, and grief. Just as our principal has mentioned, we have lost so many of our loved ones to COVID. Some of us have not been able to be there for them in their final moments or to be present at their last rites. Nothing can be more heartbreaking. Grief can also be triggered by any life-altering loss or significant life changes like divorce or a relationship breakup, losing a close friendship or a pet, moving to a new home, changing jobs, etc. Grief, if not addressed, can develop into unhealthy mental and emotional states. Thus, learning to manage our grief is very important for our emotional, physical, and mental health and well-being, as it helps us to learn how to cope with life after significant loss, to manage our reactions to triggers, and to face life again. We are honored to have Ma'am Miriam address us on the topic of grief management. Armed with a Bachelor of Arts and a Master's in Clinical Psychology, both with distinction and university gold, she is a psychologist by training and a mental health researcher at the Addictions Research Group at Sangat. She has spent the last 7 years at Sangat developing evidence-based mental health interventions for adult mental health and substance use disorders. She is particularly interested in integrating evidence-based mental health interventions into public health systems in resource-constrained settings. Her key skills are in the field of research. She has also contributed to 2 publications on intervention development for the indicated prevention of depression in later life and aging and well-being in Goa. I now invite Ma'am Miriam to take over the session. Participants, requesting you once again to turn off your mics and videos. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Braganza and Rulkat sir. That was a very kind introduction, and the honor is all mine. I thank all of you for giving me this opportunity to speak about this topic that to me is very personal, not just as a psychologist today, but also as someone who has had to cope with a lot of grief in the last 6 years. And so today I'll be sharing, as you have said, a bit about grief management, and hopefully through a discussion we reach helpful ways in which all of us can be helped manage our grief individually. So I've titled this presentation "To Cry or Not to Cry," because that essentially captures a lot of our struggles with grief, because there are so many shoulds around this. When you lose someone or a job, as someone was saying, that it's grief is not just about losing loved ones, but there are so many prescriptions or guidelines or rules about how you grieve. And so really my presentation today is to challenge all of that, because that is one of the largest barriers that come in the way of people grieving in a healthy manner. Just go ahead and see what the answer to that is. So in today's presentation, I'll briefly cover these 3 topics, that is understanding grief, particularly in the context of COVID-19, and what helps and what doesn't help us while we are grieving, and maybe strategies to support ourselves and also others around us who might be grieving. And just before we begin, of course, the content today is going to trigger a lot of emotions for, could trigger a lot of emotions for a lot of you. So I just want to let you know that that's all right if you start crying or feel sad or, you know, whatever negative emotion that some of the content may trigger. Pay attention to how you're feeling. And if you notice any of these, maybe you can step away, view some other content if you like, talk to someone about how you're feeling if it's getting too much for you, and also you can reach out for support. So I'll just put this out here again, the Sangat helpline will be open right now till 4 p.m. today and then again tomorrow. So if any of the content that we discuss today is particularly distressing or triggers some very strong emotions for any of you, please don't hesitate to call this helpline and you will get to speak to a counselor who can help you with this, with whatever emotions you are struggling with. So I hope you've made note of this, so that in case you do need it during this presentation or even later, you can reach out to Sangat. I'll have this slide at the end of the presentation as well. All right, so before we begin, I request you all to type in, if at all, so that we can keep the questions to the end. But just to make this a little interactive, if anyone would like to share, first of all, if everyone could just bring to mind someone you lost or even something It could be a loved one, family member, relative, friend, pet, or you lost something that really mattered to you, something that someone gave you. So just think of that. Take 1 minute to just bring that to mind. I'll just maintain a little silence so that you can think about that. All right. Now, if you can think of what is the most dominant emotion when you lost that someone or something, if any of you would like to share, please do type in the chat box. What was the strongest emotion when you went through that loss? And wait for a few minutes to see, or a few seconds to see if any of you would like to share. Anger, all right, thank you. Anyone else? Shock, couldn't believe, all right. Thank you all for responding. Any more, the strongest, so there are, it's usually a bag of emotions. Guilt?
It was a kind of depression.
All right, depression.
A kind guilt. Of depression where I felt I was lonely, then it was okay.
All right, so an unexpected shock, depression, guilt, a lot of emotions. And that really is what I wanted to highlight, that everyone seems to have a different emotion, a different thought. So lost everything is a thought associated with. Yes, at loss. Thank you. And that's what I wanted to highlight, that if you notice, just in the small group of people who responded, there was a range of different emotions. It wasn't just one emotion that everyone felt depressed or everyone felt guilt. Some felt anger, some felt shock. Similarly, if you can just think of, and if anyone would like to share, what was the hardest part of that loss? I think someone has shared before as well, missing their presence. Okay, I'll just use people's first names if you don't mind. That makes it easier. All right. So I think there's Judas who's been missing. Sorry.
No, unable to tolerate, and the life without that person was unthinkable.
All right. So that was the hardest part, to carry on with life without that person there. With you, that was coping up with it later. Rachel has said was the hardest part, accepting their loss, realization that you won't see that person again, to know that you will not be able to meet that person again, realizing that the person would not be present. So that seems like the most significant answer. Everyone saying that they're just carrying on with life without that person, and that realization was the hardest part. And Smita is that difficult to accept as well. Thank you all for responding. What did someone do or say that was helpful? Again, if you have been very responsive, so if anyone would like to answer, when you were going through that, in the hardest part, what did someone do or say that was helpful for you? Listening and validation, thank you. She's gone to a better place. All right, thank you, Judith. Daniela says, time will heal. Anyone else? Priyamvada said, listening and validation, emotional support, meditation, offering of food. All right. Excellent. So we have a lot of, again, a range of answers, and that essentially is the crux of my message today, that there isn't one prescription that works for everyone. Each one has different needs when they go through grief. They experience emotions very differently, and things that can help are also very different. And so we need to figure out that for ourselves and for others who we want to help as well. So let's move on. I am seeing the presentation separately. So in case there are some questions and I don't respond to them, if someone could bring them to my notice by unmuting themselves. All right, so I'll just go on. If anyone would like me to stop, please do unmute and tell, let me know if I need to stop somewhere and elaborate something. So coming to the situation, the coronavirus pandemic, right? What has happened is that these have been the key characteristics of this pandemic, which is it has increased our uncertainty. It has made the problems invisible because we are largely, you know, isolated from each other. So sometimes we are struggling with something, but since we are not meeting people, people cannot really see our struggles. And so that has been a stressor. The lack of control, really not knowing when this is going to end, not knowing how much of energy I'll have to go on. The isolation, as I said, the hardships, just generally the struggles with not having the support systems. A lot of parents may be able to empathize, saying that, you know, we have to now manage our children, manage cooking, manage cleaning. The maids cannot come. We don't have any other support. We cannot stay with our elderly parents because we are worried that they may get the virus. So, you know, really a lot of our support systems, which we depended on earlier, we've lost them. So that's also a kind of grief. And the rapid change that keeps happening, right? You think that something's gone to normal, you just begin to open and lockdowns open, and then again, such a steep rise in the cases, so many deaths, and then you start all over again. So what this image I've put here really is these book stoppers. If you all have noticed these book ends, if anyone is aware that they're just something you place on a shelf, but you can move them and add many more books. And it's not, you know, hard and fast. So they keep moving. And that somehow is like this pandemic, which is no one knows when it's going to end. It just seems it expands and then it contracts, it expands and contracts. And we are stuck in this period of limbo, which, as all of us have experienced, is extremely tiring and frustrating, because you can go through stress for a particular period of time, knowing that something will end and you know when is the end. But with this current situation, it's like we really don't know when things are going to change. So that's part of the stress, and some of the pictures I've just put here to highlight all the different kinds of losses we've had in this context. And what makes these losses difficult, right? That many of the losses that we've had in the pandemic are sudden, whether it is people's lives. 1 minute, 1 week, they were all right, and by the next week, a lot of people who contracted COVID died. So it didn't take too long time it didn't give us enough time to prepare for their death. It was just, they were fine, and within no time, they deteriorated and they died. These losses are sudden. The losses may be multiple. So I was thinking of this, you know, you've seen those car crashes where one comes, and just as you're recovering, another comes and crashes and another, and it's a whole pileup of the crash. And that's similar to what we are seeing now with the losses in COVID context. Which people have to deal with a multiple barrage of losses one after the other, which leaves us very little time to get over the previous loss and cope or get better reserves. There is lack of closure because we are not able to go for rituals, rites. We're not able to say our final goodbyes. We're not able to understand. We don't have answers for why people died. So there's a lot of lack of closure compared to previously, which even otherwise in grief, lack of closure can affect someone. The lack of physical contact, social gathering, again, I don't need to elaborate. We all have experienced this, how this loss can affect us, right? So you don't really need to lose someone by death. But even losing your friends in the fact that you're not able to meet them for 1 year in person, that is a loss. Losing your friendship, losing your the fact that you cannot go out on trips with family, or you cannot meet your family, you cannot attend weddings. So all of this, it doesn't only have to be loss in terms of death, but even loss of your routine can create the similar impacts that you would if you lost someone. So what do all of these do? They take away our power and control and our dignity and worth, value, what we've seen people say so much, what upset them about people who died during the pandemic, that they had to be you know, buried or cremated without dignity. That is what, and it really hurts the people left behind that they couldn't be sent, you know, on a new journey in a dignified manner, in the way people would have caused healing for people. And like we said right at the start, the losses are not just about death, but also losing your routine, losing the sense of normalcy. What is normal now? Also anticipation of loss, that I haven't lost someone, but I'm living in the fear that what if I lose someone, or what if I lose my job? You know, what if I lose things that I have control over? What if my relationship ends because we are so stressed in this environment working from home right now, that me and my wife are constantly arguing? That sort of fear of, you know, the loss that might come. And the other hardships about, some people have actually lost jobs. A lot of people actually, there's financial stress for people with their personal businesses, not being able to open. I mean, these things now have become, you know, the norm. Caregiving in terms of, like I said earlier, looking after younger children, but also elderly maybe, you know, in managing all of that. And just generally how drastically our life has changed. And all of this can impact us, similar to grieving the death of a loved one. So just a bit about how this is studied in terms of disaster psychology, which basically is the study of how people respond in the face of any kind of disaster, particularly, you know, natural calamities. And what we find, as you see in this graph, and the picture is slightly light, my apologies, I couldn't get a darker picture. But basically on the left is your emotional highs and lows. And as you go to the right, it is the time, right? So this first green arrow is up to 1 year, and then post that is after 1 year. And what you'll see is just before the disaster hits, your mood is all right, not very low, but it's somewhere in between. And then in the impact, it slightly dips. And then there are, as we have heard, you know, a lot of people doing all these heroic things, the community coming together, people were putting together resources. We know all of these articles where we heard of people serving meals in the hospital to relatives. So all of these things make us feel, just after the impact, we feel, especially those who are engaged in these heroic activities, they feel a surge in the mood, right? And the community feels brought together. But then after a little while, you see this dip, right? And these trigger events, these major dips in the mood, you see this pink line that I'm referring to right now, in this period of disillusionment, where people then begin to question, what is the point of all this? You know, you begin to get angry, as someone was saying, anger after the loss with the government. This anger may be directed at many different people. So you feel generally this dip. And then you see, as time goes by, in fact, after the first anniversary, gradually there's a reconstruction and people begin to then reach a better state, or even better than they were before the disaster, if you notice here, the graph shows. But one of the important things to remember is that disaster psychology has identified that not everyone, you know, responds to it in the same way as others. So they are all affected by it in some way, but not everyone responds the same way. They tend to pull together during and after the disaster, as we've just seen. And stress and grief are common reactions to these situations. And in the end, what is it? It is the people's natural resilience that will support their individual and collective recovery. If you see today, what has helped people? People have not been trained how to handle grief. People we don't have resources here. Not everyone has sought, you know, specialist's help. But we find that people are recovering. So what is it that is making people recover? It is the natural resilience that people have learned over the years, not just individually, but as a community, we encourage each other. And that is what helps us overcome these difficult situations. But like I was saying earlier, it is important also to note that not everybody is traumatized. So the same event even among this group that we are today, the same event of losing someone will have a very different response among each of us. So some might be overly traumatized that they just, everything comes to a standstill and they're extremely emotional, cannot move on with life. But for others, it seems like, okay, they've coped well and they have moved on. They're not traumatized by it. Life has changed. They are sad, but they're not traumatized. So that's important to remember. Some will have severe reactions, as I said. Some will even develop diagnosable conditions, for example, like depression, anxiety after this. So after losing a loved one, there may be this persistent, even after years, saying that I might die. If they're exercising and they have a rapid heartbeat, they start thinking, okay, am I going to die now? You know, and that causes anxiety. So they, you can, some people can develop psychological conditions post something stressful like this. But most people will not seek treatment for whatever it is that they are going through. And even the survivors will often reject help if you actually offer them. So seek treatment is passive, right? Where I come on my own. But offering help is if someone brings the help to you, that's more active. But even if you do take the help to them, a lot of survivors will reject that help. All right. So I think we'll move on and then we'll keep the questions. If you'll have any, please keep them coming and we will address them at the end. So coming to the fact of what is grief, as we've discussed and as all of you have typed in the chat box, that grief is very, very unique. It's an individual experience, but everyone understands it. We all seem to know what the other person might be going through, but it's very, very different in our experience. And also, it's not just, it doesn't just affect one part of us. It's not just emotional. It's also social. It's also spiritual. It's also physical, actually, one point that is missing here. Because sometimes people experience grief very physically, that I feel like my legs are heavy. I can't walk. Walking is, so that's a very physical symptom, right? I feel pain in my head. My eyes are heavy. So all these are physical symptoms, or I feel like I can't do anything more. Everything, my body seems so tired all the time. So these are some of the, you know, effects of grief, how people experience grief. And some people also have some spiritual seeking, soul seeking that they do in the face of grief. And what really differentiates how people experience grief? It is how they lose someone, so the circumstances in which that loss happens, their relationship. So if it was your life partner, then that's, of course, and if you have shared a good relationship with your life partner, that becomes much more stressful than, say, maybe if it was someone really distant. Your beliefs about grief, so like I said, if you have certain shoulds, that if someone's grieving, then you should do this and should not do this. And your personality trait, also your beliefs about what happens after death. And your personality traits about how you just how well you adapt to stressful situations, or how dependent are you on people, that you know, influences how you will experience grief. And I really like this this saying by Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who some of you might know is one of the foremost people who studied grief and has proposed theories around grief. And she says, as in this quote, that you will never get over the loss of a loved one. You will learn to live with it. You will heal. You will rebuild yourself around the loss. So when I think of this, have you seen this? Trees, when they are wounded, after a while they heal around that. But you always see that mark of where there was once an injury. But the tree continues to grow and it gives fruit and, you know, it fulfills its purpose. But the mark of that wound remains. And that's sort of the thought that comes to me when I think of healing after loss. Because it doesn't completely go away. There is a mark, but you do grow. You continue to grow and you heal and you will fulfill your purpose. And you shouldn't put pressure on yourself to be any other way. So just a quick comment on normal responses to loss. All of these, as some of you said, shock, disbelief, couldn't even believe that that happened. There's sometimes disorientation in the immediate after effect of loss, like not knowing, okay, where am I? What is this reality? Or is this a dream? Is this a nightmare? So these are some, and I say normal responses because immediately after the loss, it is completely fine to feel this way. So not to put any pressure on yourselves to not feel any of this. As you see, there's emotional, physical, social, and spiritual. To blame God, to question what is the meaning of our life, what is the point of everything I'm doing. So having these thoughts and feelings is completely normal right after losing someone or something. Of course, there is a question of how long can someone go on with this until they seek help. And that really, again, is individual. A key indicator is how much is it affecting your daily activities, which we'll come to shortly. And again, this is something that helped me understand grief a lot. My personal grief is that just to view it like the waves of an ocean, that sometimes they're calm and they are, you enjoy it, but sometimes they're really overwhelming and they just come to the fore all of a sudden. And all you can do is really learn to swim and be fine with both the waves. You can't demand for a certain type of wave, right? That will just make it harder. And so this has really helped me in as compared to thinking of, so Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, if some of you know, has proposed a very linear model of grief that people go through a denial, anger, bargaining, that sort of. But what we found, the recent studies have found that people do not all go through those stages, as we've said from the beginning. People have very different experiences of grief. Some may experience anger, some may experience denial, some may just experience sorrow. And it's more of a process rather than linear. And it's messy, as we all know, all of us who have experienced grief. There is a lot of questions. It seems like a whole network entangled. It doesn't seem very clear, and all of the answers, we don't have so many answers. It can change like the waves. It can change unpredictably, suddenly a huge wave. I mean, I was fine yesterday. I was coping so well. I was, and today suddenly I'm overcome with this grief that I can't do anything. I feel so, I just feel consumed by the memory of this loved one. And of course, it can catch you by surprise, and it can take time to heal. So be gentle with yourself, be kind with yourself. And you have all of these confusing thoughts and emotions, about grief. So I'll quickly go through this because just something to be mindful of, but not for us to discuss unless you all have specific questions, is to think of how different cultures help us or maybe make it more difficult for us to grieve. What are our beliefs? So, are women allowed to cry? Are men not allowed to cry? And does that make it more difficult for men to talk about how they are affected by the grief? Are people, the elders in the family supposed to be strong, but the youngers, they are allowed to express grief? And what does that say? What does that do to the elders? Does that make them make it very difficult for them? So all of these questions, just to think about if any of these are affecting you, and what is the importance of the community and religious rituals? So for example, a lot of us are used to having this communitarian goodbye to the person, right? Either in our religious rituals or otherwise. And we couldn't do any of that this time. So how has that affected us? So what is the goal of grief? The goal really is to adapt, accept, and integrate the loss. If you see this picture I've put on this slide, is this shoot coming out of the cracks. And similar to what I said about the tree earlier, that the cracks are there, but that doesn't mean that you cannot continue to grow and live a fulfilled life. And that is the goal, to be able to grow along with this loss, carry this loss along with us. And how do we do that? What does it mean to adapt and accept? It is so that the emotional intensity reduces a little, And that we are able to continue with our regular activities, and we are able to look at the future and be hopeful. We see purpose and meaning. We see that, okay, it is possible for me to be happy. And we know that we can build more relationships and have meaning from those relationships. Some things that come in the way of this goal are these myths. And these are just two that I put here, but I'm sure some of you can think of more as well that you've come across. What prevents people from living fulfilling lives after losing someone or something is if they have these beliefs that if I start feeling better, then I may forget the loved one, or it means that I don't miss them. So we hold back from showing happiness or even feeling happiness. How can I do this? They just died 1 month ago, and how can I laugh right now? How can I be, you know? So we feel guilty about being happy. And I never ever feel happy or normal again. We want to sometimes hold on to these myths. And the reason I say myths is because really they are not true. That we can feel better and we can feel normal again. And like I said, it doesn't mean that you are not acknowledging them. Their mark forever will remain in your life. All right, so quickly coming to what helps us individually, very self-explanatory, talk, share stories. As we all know that when we've lost someone, particularly if it's an elderly person, a grandparent, sharing, you know, when we went on this picnic and how they did that and how they said this. So sometimes that can really be, of course, it brings tears to us as well, but we're keeping their stories alive. We're keeping their memory alive. We are honoring them with recalling all of their stories. So that is helpful. Name your feelings means just basically calling out, like we did at the start of this session. Identifying what really am I feeling? Is it sadness? Is it guilt? Is it anger? So trying to find out what is this feeling that I'm feeling. And it doesn't have to be one. It can be multiple feelings. And allow yourself to focus on yourself and give yourself time to focus on the future, on your tasks. Okay, what do I have to do today? What do I have to do tomorrow? Participate in, you know, whatever rituals or ceremonies you can have, even if it is in the house. Some people have done Zoom or Google Meet, you know, they've joined, been able to join the rituals. And what studies have shown is that if you care for someone else, or here in this case, I've said even a plant, people who care for other things tend to find it easier to cope with the grief rather than assuming the role of someone has to care for me. You know, those people who require a lot of caring take longer to cope with the grief. Some other ideas about what you can do to help that have helped others is to cook their loved your loved one's favorite meal. You can carry a remembrance of them. You can create some artwork, put up a picture that reminds you of them. A giveaway ritual is something that, again, now we cannot do in the lockdown, but maybe you can plan for, is keep all their things, call all your friends or relatives, have a nice potluck, and then ask if each one would like a memory or remembrance of each of them, right? So you keep things that you'd like to give away of this person so that each of you has a memory of them. You can create an altar like here in this picture of all the possessions of this person that you'd like to remember, light a candle for them. When you write a letter, then keep it at this altar. You can visit their favorite spot or restaurant, location, anything that reminds you of them. You can volunteer for a cause that mattered to them. So, for example, if the person you loved also loved animals, then volunteering some time at an animal shelter to take care of animals. So that way you feel like you are in communion with this person while you are doing that activity. You can research about grief so that you understand your own feelings. You can join an online support group now. You know, a lot of other people who have lost loved ones and are sharing their experiences. And you can seek professional help from, say, organizations like us. Or anyone else that you know of. So just quickly, what are protective factors? Are basically factors that help certain people cope well with grief. And so if people have better social support groups, that is, you have friends, you have some religious groups, you have neighbors who care about you, you're more likely to cope better. If you continue doing your daily activities, you're more likely to cope better. If you have some goal for the future, and plans, you are more likely to cope better. And if you are a problem solver, okay, what is the problem here? Focus on that. What are the solutions? What can I do? Rather than, you know, just looking at it and feeling overwhelmed. Finally, the last bit, and I'll end shortly, is how do you help someone else who is grieving? So if it's not you, the first two points are really for the immediate, that is, be present without any distractions and listen to them more than you talk. And the others are more longer term. Say if you continue meeting them over the next week and 2 weeks after that, so then encouraging them to share their thoughts and feelings, help them to focus on the tasks, give them suggestions maybe of how they could healthily cope with this grief and get set goals. So few helpful things to say, since people often don't know what to say when someone has lost, and feel free to type in the chat if you disagree with any of these or if you want to add to any of this. So some things people can say are, I'm sorry to hear that you are going through this. It is normal to feel sad. It is normal to feel angry. It is normal to feel guilty. Don't be hard on yourself. This can be very hard. I can't even imagine what you must be going through. So a lot of people can understand what you're going through, but sometimes people may think you cannot understand because you have not gone through it. So a safe way to say is that I can only imagine, or I can't even imagine what you must be going through. I can see that you're hurting, or I can see that you're sad. This must be really hard for you. So just really identifying their emotions and telling it back to them so that they feel, okay, you understand them. You know, and so some more here just for you all to read. Really telling the person that you are doing the best that you can, rather than advising them, you know, you should do this, you should do that, because that may make them feel like they're not doing the best that they can. And again, just how to help them with some practical things. So if they're having difficulty with their daily tasks, then just help them to create a routine. Okay, what do you feel like doing? At least one of us. So for example, gardening is really, it helps you focus on these things that you see growing. And you know that growth really helps people to focus on the future, to focus on rebuilding, on regeneration. Make sure that they are getting good sleep, they are eating well. Like someone said, sending food was what really helped. So those are really practical things that you can help people with. And you can also help them create all of those ideas. Before I said, would you like to create a painting along with me? I can buy you the supplies. Would you like to create an altar? Let's do that. Would you like that every day we meet together at this time and pray or talk to this person? Would you like that I write a letter to this person along with you? So you can really help the person with ideas on how they would like to communicate or express their grief. And finally, setting goals. So like I said, the focus should be on today. What do I need to do? What is my priority? How can I just do that? And really not setting it for them, but together with them, identifying at least one or two things that they can focus on doing. And this is almost my last slide. The penultimate one is what not to say. So definitely don't try to give answers about what this happened because, you know, you need to move on, you need to learn, that's why they had to go, so that you would take responsibility. Let the person find their own meaning rather than we give meaning to them, because sometimes our meaning may hurt them or make them feel guilty. I know how you feel, you must stay strong. So that is something that a lot of people say, and I know that it's well-intentioned, but it also affects the person in the sense that then they bottle up their emotions. And I say this because a lot of people who call us say that, you know, everyone's telling me to stay strong, so I have no one to talk to, so I'm calling you and I want to talk to you. So really allow people the freedom to not be strong, and to break down, to cry. Of course, you might say that they cannot break down or cry in front of, say, another person who needs that support. But then you be the person that they can break down and cry in front of, right? So don't put pressure on people to stay strong. Don't say things like it was their time to go. That might hurt people. You know, and these other few things that, again, might be well-intentioned. And I'm open to your feedback to saying if you all say that this is helpful and we need to say it, we can have a discussion about this. And finally, my last slide, these are things that really helped me in my grief. I keep thinking that no matter how difficult the storm is, every storm eventually passes. That no matter how strong, there is no storm that has begun 50 years ago and is still going on, at least to my knowledge. They do subside. So just wait it out. Let the storm calm down. And you are having a reasonable response to an unreasonable circumstance. So don't be hard on yourself for your response. Be kind to yourself. And that's it. I'll leave it at this so that we can have a discussion. And there are some questions here that have come up. Can you please elaborate what has been the worst part of this? Daniela, were you saying, was this a question for me, or were you suggesting that these are things we can say to people to help them with grief? Daniela, would you like to elaborate your question, please?
Ma'am, it was according to the slide what you had put, like what we can say to the person. Can you please elaborate? It was the question, like it was like part of it saying what has been the worst part of this.
All right. So you remember at the start of this this webinar, I asked you all what was the worst part or the hardest part of losing the loved one. And we did get a lot of responses that just, you know, so it's just in a conversation, some things to say rather than advise. And that's really the key message. When we go to console someone who's grieving, we feel a pressure to say things that will help them feel better. But the key message that I want to give is that you need to ask open questions to let them express themselves and really ask them, how would you like me to help? What is it that I can do for you? And within that, one of the questions when they are talking is, you know, what has been the hardest part for you about all of this? And following that up with, I can see why that is hard. I can see that is really hurting you even when you're talking about it. How can I help you with this? So you're asking what has been the hardest part so that you can offer help if required. Does that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am. Satisfied.
Miriam, okay, could do one thing. Yes. Miriam, we could do one thing. We could do a role play.
Okay. Sure. Do we have time for that?
Yeah. It's 3:52, so we do have time.
All right. So how would you like? Would you like someone to play the...
I will say something and then you reply.
Sure. Sure. I can hear you very faint, though. I don't know if it's just me or...
Okay. Can you hear now?
Yes, yes.
Now you can hear me clearly?
Yes, I can hear you.
So I call you and I say that, Miriam, I'm feeling really, really low.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I lost a very close friend of mine.
Mm-hmm.
I feel that I was not able to take him to hospital in time. I was not mm-hmm. able to guide him in time.
Mm-hmm.
So if I had taken him earlier, maybe, you know, he would have survived.
Mm-hmm. First of all, Prashanti, I'm so sorry to hear that you've lost someone so close. What I sense in what you're telling me is there's some guilt about not being able to do enough to save your friend. Am I understanding you right?
Yeah.
Would you like to tell me more about that? How is this affecting you?
No, I feel that he was so healthy. In fact, he went walking to the hospital
mm-hmm.
and chose one of the best hospitals. And we thought that all the help and all the best doctors were around. And mm-hmm. still nothing could happen.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's very, very difficult to, you know, understand and accept what happened.
Mm-hmm. So I hear you saying also that y'all did find him the best care. Y'all found the best hospital. And despite that there was nothing really you could do. And also, but at the same time, you spoke earlier about feeling guilty about not doing enough. So can you help me understand that a bit more?
No, I think maybe if we had taken him to Bombay,
mm-hmm.
maybe some other better place, he would have mm-hmm. survived.
Mm-hmm.
No, that and is what really... I think. Feeling, and he himself was saying. that I would like to go to Bombay.
And what really prevented you from taking him to Bombay?
Doctor said that he was not very strong to travel. He couldn't be off oxygen.
So to me, it sounds like what you're saying is that you all were really trying to give him the best options that he could, but there were certain barriers that prevented you all from doing anything further, in addition to what you said about his condition not being suitable to take him, to move him from the hospital. There were also these restrictions around the lockdown. So what I really hear is that you all have done everything you could for your friend to provide him the best care within the circumstances that were around you at that moment. Is that right?
Yes.
And I think so. Sorry?
This is enough, no? I mean,
yeah, all right.
People would have got clarity about how to converse.
Yes. Yes. So, Prashanti, if you have any sort of comments about what I said, or then we can ask others as well what I was doing.
I felt that, you know, the confusion which was there in my mind, you answered those questions by, you know, taking my own whatever information I gave you. On the basis of that, you tried to explain.
Yes.
I think that helps, that sometimes you have this knot in your mind and that gets resolved.
Yes. And it's not so much I did not advise you. I did not jump to say that, Prashanti, don't think like that. You did everything you could, right? I just asked you with open-ended questions about what makes you feel that guilt. And what really, and you said, because I thought maybe we could do so much more. And I said, okay, what more could you do? And so all of the responses were from you. And so it is, you know, more likely that you will be convinced. Otherwise, what happens when we advise? Sometimes when we leave, then the person begins to think, I mean, at that moment, I felt right, but maybe they don't know the whole situation, you know. So really just asking questions, let the person answer, and pointing out, helping them identify their feelings when they are responding. So, for example, if the person had to say, the doctors weren't doing enough, we were asking the doctors again and again, what? And so then you say, I'm sensing some anger in your, you know, what you're saying as well. Is that right? Are you a little angry about the way the doctors? So just helping people identify their emotions in what they are saying, and relaying back that to them and helping them problem solve. So for example, if I had to continue, I would ask you, so how is this continuing to affect your daily life, your activities, and then problem solve about how we could start maybe one activity at a time so that you can get back your routine. I'm just going through some of the questions. Suggest some therapeutic intervention for grief. Is this as a counselor that you would like to that you want an intervention, or is it at an individual level for yourself? The question is by Sorna Meena K. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. My apologies. Is it appropriate to ask the person as an individual, ma'am? Yeah, so as an individual, and I'm happy to share my content of this with all of you. I'll share it as a PDF. So you can just go through that again in detail as the things that I listed out about what helps, the different grief sort of rituals. That can be, some people just like to write in a journal. But basically, all of the interventions are to help yourself express your grief rather than cover it and move on. Because as a society, that's what people push us to do. Get over it. Come on, move on. Life needs to go on. But really, the grief interventions have to be that, okay, sit with your grief for a little while in a healthy manner, and then, you know, carry on with your other activities. So I'll share the slides with you so that you can look at it again and identify some ideas to help at an individual level. Is it appropriate to ask the person who has delivered the news of their loss what happened? When is the appropriate time to ask what happened? So really, again, this is a very personal, individual level question. I personally prefer not to ask what happened at that moment. But after a while, maybe when the person recontacts, then you can ask. But when you first informed about a loss, just saying, being there for the person. So it depends on why you're asking that question. Is it to satisfy your own curiosity, or is it to help the person, right? So that really should direct your questions. If asking what happened will help this person, then yes. But if you know that person well enough to say that they don't want to get into the details, then you don't ask what happened. And you ask whenever the person is ready to talk about it. So one simple rule about this, what to ask, what not to ask, is you can be very upfront about the person to the person and say, see, I'm not really sure what's helpful. So if you know what you'd like me to do at this moment, please let me know. Or another way to do that is, would it help talking about what happened? I'm here to listen. So that way, you know, so if the person, you're giving the person the option to say, I really don't want to talk about what happened right now. So just check when you're not sure about what would be helpful and what not. Ask them. I'm not sure if this will be helpful at this moment, but if it is, please let me know if talking about what happened would help you. I'm happy to listen. Really like the way you explain everything. Thank you. That is Harshal. The world breaks everyone, and afterward, many are strong at the broken places. Yes, that is. And not necessarily, so that is true. A lot of people are strong at the broken places. But a lot of people continue, that continues to be their weak point, and that's all right. That is also another key message that I want to give, that you don't feel the pressure to be repaired in a certain way because someone else is repaired or strong for the grief. If the that continues to be a soft spot, and that's just make sure that it doesn't affect your functioning. Harshal has a last comment. To what extent is grief normal, and after what point does it become pathological? Is it fine to classify any act, emotion as pathological? A good question, Harshal. Again, because we are going with this of grief as a very individual experience, we don't have a lot of diagnostic conditions have, if this low mood continues for 2 weeks, then you seek help, or for 6 weeks, then you, so there's a time period. But for grief, we go more with the functional. So if someone's not doing any activities, not taking care of themselves, and just grieving and lying in bed, say for more than 2 weeks, then that is something where you need to start intervening in. But if someone is still hurt, grieving, talking to you, like I said, like the waves, suddenly sometimes it comes up, but is able to focus and do a lot of things, then that's not pathological for sure. So there's no clear-cut answer about that from me, but I'm happy to hear if anyone else has a different view. But really right now, the view is about how people are able to function while carrying the grief with them, so that it really doesn't affect your relationships, your jobs, and others. How can I overcome the grief that I could not help my friend when she needed me as she was diagnosed with COVID? So if I understand this question correctly, Judith, is it about that you lost your friend?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. And so right now you feel guilt about not doing enough.
Yeah, in fact, she was a maid in a complex working for us, and she mm-hmm. was very close to me. Mm-hmm. She used to be of any help to me whenever I wanted her. But mm-hmm. when she was diagnosed with COVID, she was alone. She has no husband. She was a widow, no children. Mm-hmm. And it was like our complex people were the family for her. We did everything. We admitted her to the hospital, etc. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we could not get a person to stay with her when she needed. Mm-hmm. Because she was COVID positive, though we tried a lot. Yeah. And when okay. by the time we got a person, she was no more. So yeah. that guilt that she was there for me always and I couldn't do anything keeps yeah. on, you know, hurting me. And I keep on crying.
Yeah, sure. I'm sorry to hear that. And yes, I can hear in your voice as well, you know, the intensity of the grief. And that's really, like I was saying earlier, grief is so complex that it's not just a sadness, but it usually is accompanied with these other emotions like grief, like the guilt that you are experiencing right now. Unfortunately, I don't think we can help you. I can help you in this session. I'm happy to talk to you separately if you need. So please feel free to get in touch with me and let me know if you'd like to talk more about this. Does that sound all right?
Okay, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Feel better, ma'am.
Yeah. What about overthinking in grief? So, Rashmi, that is called rumination. Again, that is coming out of the fact that you think you might have been able to do a lot of other things. And really, the psychological treatment for rumination is behavioral activation. And so I'm happy to share again. I think we've come to the end of our time, right? It's like overshooting our time. So you can feel free to get in touch with me. I can share resources with you about how to overcome that specifically. Yeah, should we stop here because of the time?
I think we can.
I have a question. Okay.
Yes.
Hello.
Please go ahead. Yes.
See, as teachers, when we are dealing with students, when they are facing such kind of problems, what happens that we cannot give advice sitting in a comfortable place. We cannot give advice that do this and do that. Okay. And there are some two students who approached me and then they said that the whole family got into COVID and the breadwinner is not working. And then they had their own financial problems plus the health. No one was there to take them to the hospital. So when such situations, when they tell like that, we are helpless. And in what way we can help? Because I try to contact people and then somehow I manage to help them. But in certain cases, because of COVID, we cannot go personally to go and help, as Judas had told. So in such situations, we cannot give even advice. Mm-hmm. So what after this, whatever had happened, after experiencing all this, then we, as teachers, we cannot be judgmental that, oh, this person is not attending because he's not willing to attend the lecture or giving excuse. That question, we can maybe one or two may do that, but on the whole, the students are not like that. So when they call and tell that this is the problem, so how to go about and how, what, because advice is not advisable, and what should we do?
So if I've understood your question, what you're saying is that when students report some certain challenges they're having at home because of which their academic work is suffering, you're asking how you can be of support to the student without advising them. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. And so what really is your goal? Do you want that the student is able to do their academics, or is it that you want to help them deal with the home situation, or is it both?
First, it is the home situation.
You want them to deal better with the home situation.
Home situation.
All right.
Yeah.
So yes, I mean, if you have certain suggestions of what can help, definitely we suggest. But I suppose what I mean by not advising is the way to do it, right? So you do it, you begin the conversation like I did with Prashanti, which is to say, you know, how this is what I'm hearing you say, that these are the main challenges that you have at home. Would you like me to suggest anything that could be helpful? But before that is, what have you all been trying so far to manage the situation? What is helping you get through this situation? So just ask a few open questions to understand what they are doing already, and then say, all right, so it sounds like you are doing all of these things. I wonder if you would like to also try this. So you're really checking with them first. Would they like to get your advice? And if they say yes, please suggest something how I can overcome this. Then you go ahead and say, you know, this has helped someone else. Do you think you can try this? And have a discussion about these different suggestions that you have. So don't, what I meant is don't just jump to give advice, but first really understand the person's challenges, understand what they've already done to cope with it, and then ask if they'd like your advice, and then of course offer suggestions and advice. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, someone had some more questions. I don't want to sound insensitive, but are there any benefits to grief, considering the fact that it has subsisted in humans and since the start of man? Any reasons why it hasn't been eliminated by evolutionary process? A very interesting question. I do not have the evolutionary perspective's answer to that. Are there benefits? People do tend to take meaning out of this, out of grief, and like we said, it depends on people's beliefs about grief. But yeah, as individual as grief is, similarly the experience or the benefits that people get from grief are different. But that's a very philosophical question that might have a different, an entire session or even a book on itself. Yeah. I don't have the answer to that. All right, I'm only cognizant of the time, so please feel free, the organizers, to let me know when you would like to end. I've put some resources up on the last slide. Sangat's doing a lot of COVID relief. So the listening circles is just a group of people, anyone, you can register as well and come and listen and share your experiences about how other people are dealing with COVID. And anything that you'd really like to share, it's facilitated by someone. People from all over India join, so feel free to join. There are Hindi and English listening circles. You can get all of this information on our website, www.sangat.in. So feel free to go there. There are a lot of handouts that you can download and share with others. So you can choose based on the condition, depression, anxiety, grief, dealing with children, problems. So feel free to visit the website and take what resources you need.
Yeah. We have one more question coming up.
Would you have any idea about why we would possibly have dreams about the person we have lost recently? Yes, that is a way of, and that's a very common way of coping with grief, because you are remembering the person, and especially can be heightened for people who are consciously avoiding thinking about the person, that they come up in grief. And it's not just for grief, it can also be for other things that you are avoiding thinking about, or it's the last thing that you think about when you go to bed, then you tend to have those in your dreams. Yeah, escape practice and means to those which we could not do in reality. Yeah, thank you, Arshan.
Okay. Since, do we have more questions?
Telecounseling is available in English, Marathi, Hindi, Konkani. Yes, I think we'll stop here. My kid okay. is up as well.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am Miriam, for this interactive and informative session and the deep insights into different aspects of grief and its management that you touched upon. I would like to call upon my colleague, Anupa Naik, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Application, to propose a vote of thanks and conclude this session.
Thank you, Madani Ma'am. Respected principal, resource person, faculty members, students, and my dear participants. They say no duty is more urgent than duty of giving thanks. Thus, it is our duty to thank all the participants who have attended today's webinar. To start with, I would like to thank Ms. Mariam Siquera, resource person for today's webinar, for taking time out of our busy schedule and guiding us. The words of wisdom will surely help us to cope with difficult times, especially during the ongoing pandemic. Thank you to our principal, Professor D.B. Arulkar. He has been a constant pillar of guidance and motivation. His support has played a great role in all our accomplishments. Gratitude is also due to our dearest vice principal and convener of counseling cell, Ma'am Rashmi Redkar, for a constant guidance and encouragement. I would also like to thank Ma'am Prashanti Talpankar. She has been in forefront in making all the necessary arrangement to make this event possible. Also, thank you to Melanie Braganza for comparing the event. To all the participants, faculty members, professionals and students, a big thank you for attending this webinar. Without you, this event would not have been possible. Thank you one and all once again.
Thank you all so much for all those kind words, and also for those who have typed in the chat. I'm glad it was helpful, and I'll share my slides with you all. And for those who have specific needs, please feel free to reach out to me separately. Thank you.
One minute before we go, we will just have a photo.